Hello, hi. Today is Friday and it's the 6th of September 2024, date and time here in the Philippines. So once again, I am, before you making this recording, I guess I do not want a live telecast to compromise the intention behind this video recording. I would like to answer directly some questions that had been posted to others, and also to questions that I myself had been asked in times past. So I am not as nicely turned out today because this is how I usually look without, without any makeup. Like if you come over our house, this is, of course, I just comb my hair. And with or without visitors, and to start the day right, I think we should comb our hair. And yeah, like hygiene, brushing my teeth. So I took a pause because there's a noisy truck passing by our house. So I'm still here at 1791 CM Rectus Street, Pleasantville Subdivision, Ilayang Iam, Luzon City. And I am recording this video because I do not want to compromise the intention, which can happen if it's an impromptu, like it's a live stream where I will not be able to correct a not so thoughtful choice of words. So it is not meant to antagonize or cast aspersion or criticize, especially fellow believers, and considering that I have been friends with them. So that's a clue actually how and what is the gist of this recording. So the question that I had an opportunity to answer back then was, who are you with, like in the production, in your video recording, in your podcast? Why are you alone? So in order to answer that, I have to go back to those times wherein I was part of a project, especially in the church. I had been so very much a part of the leadership, if I can claim that. I was part of a group. So right now, I had been doing this solo when I had run out of funds, the budget. I can run on fumes, but I cannot expect other people, especially those believers with responsibilities. It's not a good, I don't want to be the reason why they will not be able to pay their bills, or why they will have their name lashed out, or the backlash of credit that had gone unpaid. For my part, it was a an expected consequences of not being able to be financially stable, and for a not rewarding occupation. This is the lifestyle that I have. It's a consequence of the intentional and conscious choices that I made that had been open, laid open, that if anybody would be willing to share the notoriety, you know, the bad name, to be able to pursue something that means a lot to a person, like it means a lot to me that I had traded my good name, a good credit standing. So that was the cost of doing this, and I cannot expect other people not without conviction. I am not saying that, you know, their faith is less than, and that I am more, you know, more righteous and I am more admirable. It is just that this is something that I am willingly, eyes wide open, consequences, every day had been a choice of painful or more painful. I have to walk under the sun. I had to take, you know, the extra miles before any, you know, for any objective can be reached, because such is the condition that my reality. And so it is not to spite, or we call that in Tagalog, ipamukha, na for those others who are, you know, well off now and comfortable compared to my lot. So that is the reason why I am alone. I was open for any joiner or for any volunteer to be beside me, but for me to change my trajectory, if I am so willing to trade off a good name and a reputation for this, so you could imagine how much it means to me that if someone would be, you know, would offer me, would offer to do this, to have a platform shared, but with different messages, and that we would be differing in the content, I had rather that they would do so, and I would, you know, somehow encourage them to pursue it on their own, because of we are being both truthful to our calling, and quote and unquote. So with regards to being an unchurch, I consider myself as unchurch as of today. I have in a very unique situation wherein the process that I am going through right now could easily undermine my peace of mind and the peace within the community that I am part of. Like, it would be so easy to doubt the sincerity of another person, because in times past, everything that we had shared, confidences, secrets, I had a misfortune of being at the raw end, of being the one quoted, and being the one who had to bear the brunt of course, of hurt feeling, of being offended, of confidences that had been that had reached the concerned persons, some privacies had been invaded because of this breach. And so I had to take a sabbatical leave in order for me not to look at my fellow believer, to my brother and sister, with so much suspicion, with hurt feelings, So I would rather, you know, attribute this as, you know, a part of the maturity of, and part of it is that I had to admit that I was wrong and that I had to, you know, go through the consequences. I lost the business. I lost, you know, good fellowship. Some doors had been closed. For me, so I took it as part of the, part of the maturity growing process. So I decided, you know, to take a break in order to be ministered, to become, you know, for me not to be defocused or not to be distracted by my own feeling of hurt and indignation that, oh my gosh, why am I being the made to bear all of that when I was it wasn't a one-man show. Everything, I had somebody at the other end of the conversation. I was always part of a group. I was always part of a conversation, so it was very, I had felt that way. It was very unfair that I alone would be castigated and would suffer losses and damages in terms of opportunity, in terms of benefit of the doubt. And so it was better, you know, not to drag the name of those. I can name drop na, don't blame me, blame also her and him and they, because so I had rather, you know, nurse my myself with the blessings that still came my way in spite of that. So I was able to smile and mean it, not resent how others would look more prosperous than compared to my impoverished state. So it was not by choice, this one-man show. Budget, and then the circumstances, and then third, the peace of the community. If I had not taken away myself from the equation of you are that kind of person and me having to defend myself and the future and the family, like we're not suffering, we're not harboring from any, you know, delusion of grandeur, from any illusion of, you know, all those labels that I had to sort out and outgrow by through time, and not through shouting matches, not through confrontation, but, you know, time. So all those things had been done without irreparable tear in the community, where the rest of the community or the bystanders or the other churches would be forced to take a stand on who to believe. Like I had been part of other churches before the Lucena Bible Church and Global Missionary Fellowship now, who, that is the name of the church, that the last church that I had attended, but before that I came from other church. By, you know, by forcing the issue, we would have been, you know, the resentment would have festered, and that I may smile and laugh and talk on the outside, but inside I would feel really raw. And so it would force, you know, the other believers to take a stand, to choose a side, because we would be like he said, she said, interpreting our actions and statements to each other one way and then defending ourselves in some other venues in our own way. So it would have brought so much discord in the church. So I would rather that if I had been less convinced that this is the way that I should go, I would have yielded, as in times past. I always had yielded. The reason I had multiple opportunities and deals, it was because of my laid back. I really don't want to force an issue. I would rather, you know, give in, and I would rather not take it its final course of it's my way or the highway. That's what Pastor Ralph La Rosa would always utter. So I wasn't like that. The reason that I was getting along and I was quite, you know, popular, and I was I could be somehow, I could give fun, I could contribute fun to a party, it's because of my personality, which is not, you know, I didn't stand for a lot of things. I could easily, you know, bow down and not force an issue. So until the time in my life wherein I had been in a very perplexing situation, and thereby when I had, you know, heeded, and I had, you know, taken this prayerfully, considering the plus and minus, the advantages and the disadvantages, I had before, you know, only after I was able to write and with many consultations and considered the options, the consequences of any decision that I had to make. It was only then that I had, for the first time in my life, taken a stand that was very unpopular and very controversial. It was a first in me. I was not characterized by it. That's why the, you know, any attributes funny to weird to bizarre had been thrown as a way to explain the sudden change in my belief, my behavior, my choice, my lifestyle. And it was so very unpopular, the views that I had held. It runs contrary to how being a Christian would be, like in the middle ground. And so because of the circumstances that had happened, full of hurt feelings and full of blame game, it wasn't easy to let so many things slide and just to go back to, you know, go back to business, back to the normal routines. So what I want to read also is in that by doing it alone, the question that I had entertained in my decision was, would I be hurting the church that I would be leaving behind by my action of not being an active member of it? And I want to approach this with, you know, the not so, because we have In times past, we associate certain practices with that of being ultra Pentecostal, or you know, with the labels. I don't mean any disparaging comment about it, but it is undeniable the split in the church with the different denominations. To this day, I still believe that I have benefited so much from the approach that Pastor Ralph LaRosa had chosen to study and to teach us the Word of God. Like, we have not discarded common sense and our intellect. We did not leave the intellect and the, you know, the common sense at the doorstep whenever we enter the church. So it's nothing like that. So I am still so thankful for that. I was able to flourish in my own journey. Yes. So with that kind of atmosphere, our questions were answered with doctrines, sound doctrines, and which are grounded with the Word of God, or grounded from the scriptures, from the Bible. So I am so thankful for that. And this will be, this is my answer also to that. Did I harm, or have I, you know, by pursuing a course that had took me away from how I was from the point that I had realized so many things about my life, which will not be a sound choice of action, course of action for another, because we have been given a different set of circumstances. And I have time and time again said that it is not to promote certain, you know, lifestyle, or convince others of my superiority, or that I had, you know, eureka, I had found something that, you know, it's earth-shattering. It's nothing like that. I was just convinced that the course of action that I am taking, it's also that have taken me away from that equation, was a sound course of action, and it had brought, it should bring healing. Because had it not happened, oh my gosh, we would still be engaged now with lawsuit after lawsuit, with so much chaos within the family, and our children would have to live with parents who are so angry and bitter and, you know, so out of focus, and you know, our imperfections brought by unresolved conflicts. So I want to say that how I made my actions, my decisions, is still within the discipline that Pastor Ralph had instilled in us. Like, it still follows the common sense. It still follows how we should obey the authorities and the law of the land, as not being in conflict with the written will of God through the Bible. And that I have not listened, I have not put my ears in the walls, or on the walls listening to God saying, "Hey, Clarissa." So, and I have not been obsessed with any male personality that can be, that can find it so perplexing, and that can bring discord in the church. So all these things had settled, we were able to live life peacefully while exploring the horizon. Through the same principles that had guided us. So by not leaving out common sense, by still being law-abiding citizens, I am able to understand how the scientific community, yes, the science, wherein it's not an exclusive choice of the illogical faith, and how I want to raise the fact that humankind have reached so much because of science, because of the discipline and the methodology, the scientific methodology that the scientific community have shared with the rest of the world, right? And I can testify to how that kind of approach also helps us in studying the Word of God. And so I want to continue with that pattern and with that parallel principles that to this day is guiding me, as well as I know the Global Missionary Fellowship. The five characteristics of science, empirical, replicable, provisional, objective, and systematic. So yes, I am able to take myself out of the equation. I had physically removed myself from Global Missionary Fellowship because of the conflict that, in the way that had brought so much turmoil within my own family and with the rest of the affected personalities, and here in Lucena City, common friends. Excuse me. So by taking myself away, the empirical facts, the empirical data remain. I did not bring it with me. The replicable processes are employed by the church in order to disciple, in order to teach other believers. No man is indispensable in the kingdom of God, right? We all have a role to fulfill, and that God causes all things to work together for the good of those who love Him and who have been called according to His purpose. So I know that my spot that I had vacated, God has a plan for that as well. I am replaceable. and 3 provisional. You know, we can improve on the, especially in hindsight, what had happened. Assuming, of course, that I was not regarded as the sole bearer of the problem or the cause of the problem, and that the fault is shared by the imperfection of other believers. So, therefore, you know, the modification, the way of life, can help us all. And number 4th, objective, and this is hard when we are hurt and we have to nurse, you know, grudges, and we have to assign blame and misgiving and regrets. So it's really a very personal, that only the heart can feel its own authentic real joy. You know, I may be experiencing the benefit of real peace, but I cannot. It's a first person point of view. I can only speak for myself, and we all have to be objective about it, and then systematic. The way that, you know, it was like in the Bible study, and of course I did not take it with me when I left. It's still there. And that by also having my own platform, which is very public, which is so, so open, since I have been antagonized and evaluated and diagnosed endlessly for a very, very long time, what can stop any person from coming forward with a differing view, with a specific objection, and, you know, calling me into account for anything that I may say, which can be believed to be damaging or hurting or very false, heresy. It's, you know, if I can dish it out, I can also receive it. And for a very, very long time, for the minutest detail of my life, it had been laid open and interpreted in oh so many different ways, clinical, psychological, whichever way. So any view that I share, any work that I do offer to the public, I have no reason to think that it can stop any viewpoint that is different. And this is also a way for me to announce how I would be limiting my broadcast like this, because I am going to have my own way to go back to my writing career. So it's the only way for me to earn and, you know, take care of the responsibilities that I had neglected. So I have now, I believe I have a way now to redeem myself, first to my family, to whom I had, you know, they are the first affected persons by the choices that I made. I have a lot to make up for it, and I believe I have found a way to make up for the losses by God's grace. It's really, truly amazing. To continue with parallelism and distinction, I want to read from an article here in Stanford, Stanford Encyclopedia of Philosophy, about scientific method. So it was first published Friday, November 13th, 2015. And then with substantive revision Tuesday, June 1st, 2021. So see the similarities. Yes, the most illuminating method that, you know, the publisher and the scientific community can adapt in order to communicate their whatever they want to offer the public or to their peers. They want to devise a way to communicate it effectively. And so is the Word of God. But here, in this introduction of the revision, substantive revision, the Bible doesn't have this categorically, and it will oppose any action or to the effect that it would have any part of it would be subject to revision. So science is an enormously successful human enterprise. The study of scientific method is the attempt to discern the activities by which that success is achieved. Among the activities often identified as characteristic of science are systematic observation of experimentation, inductive and deductive reasoning, and the formation and testing of hypotheses and theories. To continue, how these are carried out in detail can vary greatly, but characteristics like these have been looked to as a way of demarcating scientific activity from non-science, where only enterprises which employ some canonical form of scientific method or methods should be considered science. See also the entry on science and pseudoscience. So the way that you know, the church is continuing with its ministry, the last time I had attended, so many new faces. I am so glad that there had been many new faces in the church, and that whenever we see each other, we bump into each other, there would always be pleasantries, and I would, on my part, I am warmed there by the warmth of the greetings for each other. And so I would think that you know, what Pastor Alf had started is being continued by the leadership. And I just want to get this in there. Scientific methods should be distinguished from the aims and products of science, such as knowledge, predictions, or control. Methods are the means by which those goals are achieved. Scientific methods should also be distinguished from methodology, which includes the values and justifications behind a particular characterization of scientific method. Values such as objectivity, reproductivity, simplicity, or past successes, and so on and so forth. So, while it is important to recognize these distinctions, their boundaries are fuzzy. Hence, accounts of method cannot be entirely divorced from their methodological and meta-methodological motivations or justifications. Moreover, each aspect plays a crucial role in identifying methods. So this, for the rest of what I have to say, this is my own interpretation of it, and not just as a, in response to the issues I have with the church. For me, the law of nature, or what has been established by God for this world, should there should be some constant factor or constant. That the constant and unmovable or unchanging attributes which can give rise to empirical data, because without, you know, the constant and predictable cycles, there is, it will be hard to arrive at empirical certainty. It will not be replicable. So if you know, in contrast, of course, we as Christians believe in answered prayers and in how God intervenes. But such, you know, such intervention should not make it impossible for the scientific community to attain the level of constant and unchanging nature or cycle that they will not be able to replicate any system, or the process of discovery or invention will not happen again, that everything would be by chance and everything will be guided by how great our prayers or our prayer life would be. Like, if everything will depend on how great our prayer life is, we're gonna be doomed, and there would be a non-existent scientific community, like, you know, botany, biography. And so we have to rely on the what God has instituted, the independence of it. And that was what I was saying in my what I was referring to in my what I had uploaded on my FB. Some systems need to be amoral because God had designed it to be that way, or else, you know, any systematic approach and methodology will be non-existent. So it's a balancing, actually, and that only God has perfected the formula when things will happen because of his answer to a prayer, and when is it happening because it is in his nature and it is the what he had instituted in the beginning, in the creation of this world. And so these things that I have, this kind of thoughts that I am sharing, which I hope will also bring awareness to God's pervasive presence, and it's my own way of sharing my faith, which I is in no way as a slight or to cast aspersion, to proclaim how I think I am superior to another believer who may differ in belief or differ in priority. So it's just that in my the legal status that I also keep updating, and which I am sharing, because I am a product at this point in time, I am a product of different two processes, legal proceedings. And so it actually plays a crucial factor in my day-to-day life. It's the reality that governs the decision. And so with that, I hope also to the rest of what I have to say will, of course, will be on account of answers to questions that would be asked of me, God willing, in the US. So thank you so much, and this is yours truly, Clarice T.